Welcome to Free Thoughts from Libertarianism.org and the Cato Institute. I'm Aaron Ross Powell, editor of Libertarianism.org and a research fellow here at the Cato Institute.
And I'm Trevor Burrus, a research fellow at the Cato Institute Center for Constitutional Studies. Our guest today is Alex Epstein, president and founder of the Center for Industrial Progress and author of the new book, The Moral Case for Fossil Fuels. Alex, you describe your book as a secret history of fossil fuels. What do you mean by that?
Well, it's actually chapter one is a secret history of fossil fuels. And I want to begin the book by questioning the idea that all of the leading experts, or at least the people media present to us as the leading experts, are actually in that position because they have demonstrated superior ability, and in particular a superior ability to make accurate predictions about the future, because you hear about 97% of climate scientists agree with X, and we can talk about what they agree with and whether that's a valid kind of summary. But people like Paul Ehrlich and Bill McKibben and James Hansen, there's the assumption that, well, if they're at the top of the pyramid, at least as reported by media, they must be accurate, and there's this implication that maybe we should be intimidated by them and defer to them. And I don't think you should ever do that, but it's particularly important to ask, hey, what is their track record? What's the track record more broadly of this idea that fossil fuel use is going to lead us to an unlivable planet? And this usually has three components: that it will lead to catastrophic resource depletion, that it will lead to catastrophic pollution, and that, of course, it will lead to – of course, to them – it will lead to catastrophic climate change. And what's interesting and what the secret history of fossil fuel is that these predictions pretty much in the exact same form have been made for the last 30 to 40 years by many of the same people and have not only been a little bit wrong but have been exactly opposite to the truth. And you know, in the following sense, if you look at our resource situation, if you look at our pollution situation, if you look at the actual livability of our climate, how many people die from storms and heat waves and droughts and floods today versus the past, every single one of those has gotten way, way better, and it can be very strongly connected to the use of machines powered by cheap, plentiful, reliable energy from fossil fuels. So that indicates something is very wrong with the way we think, and I found that an effective way to open to at least challenge the framework that the people who are telling us everything today and posing as experts actually deserve the deference that they get.
And I like your book because the way its focus is different. It's not on – it's not focused on, you know, why climate change is a myth or things like this. It's focused on the other side, which you almost never hear. There are big things you get from fossil fuels that you have to balance this against, and all we do is talk about – we seem to think that there are no costs to – all the proposals that are out there for limiting fossil fuel use.
Yeah, and I think ultimately what it is it's trying to look at the issue of fossil fuels in context, which I don't think is very well done in most discussions on either side. So I analogize it to thinking about taking a prescription drug. So you take a prescription drug, it has certain effects, you know, it has an effectiveness as the FDA would call it for all the FDA's problems, and then it has certain risks and side effects. And to decide whether to take it, you have to look at all of those. Imagine if you just looked at the side effects but you didn't look at the efficacy of it. You would make very, very bad decisions. Or if you only looked at the efficacy but you didn't look at the side effects. So you need to look at both, and you need to look at them with precision. And you need to have a clear goal, which in the context of a drug is your health, and I think in the context of fossil fuels or anything else should be human well-being. And one thing I argue in the book is that our discussion is very much not driven by a focus on the big picture, and it's also not oriented toward human well-being. And that's a controversial claim, but I think if we examine in more depth, we see that a lot of the thought leaders on the environmentalist side are not optimizing for human well-being. They're optimizing for minimizing human impact on the planet, and I argue that that is not a pro-human goal at all.
Well, there are certainly some people who think that the proper approach to dealing with the environment is that we all should kind of live as the Amish do, or you know, radically reduce all of our usage of anything energy related. A lot of people are arguing for simply alternatives. So they're saying things like, you know, yes, we need the energy, and it's good that we have the energy, and it's good that we have these machines powered by the energy, but there are these non-fossil fuel alternatives like solar and wind and hydroelectric and whatever else that would give us that without the environmental costs of fossil fuels.
Mm-hmm. Well, so it's important, the aspect that I mentioned before in terms of looking at risks and benefits with precision. I think a lot of the environmental cost arguments are not doing that whatsoever. They're also not looking at many of the environmental benefits of energy, including fossil fuels. But I think that the main thing there is that what does it mean to say that I'm proposing alternatives? I mean, it's like saying I'm proposing alternative phones to the iPhone. Okay, are you building one or are you making one up? Or are you saying you should have the freedom to build one? And what we should be doing, I think, as citizens, assuming we're not actually building them, is pretty much shut up about which alternatives are best and simply say we want a society where people are free to build different things and not sort of prejudice ourselves and say, oh, it needs to come from the sun or it needs to come from the wind or we'll only use something if we think we can use it for the next billion years, which I think is a ridiculous kind of concept that we don't say that about a phone. I only want the phone if we can – all the materials will last for the next billion years. You say I want the best phone. Same thing with energy. You should say that about energy. So the people who say, oh, I'm in favor of these alternatives, what they're usually in favor of is wildly impractical alternatives. If you use the term alternative energy, it's really an alternative to what actually works on the market. It's usually uneconomic energy. And solar and wind, I discuss a lot in chapter 2 of the book, looking at the different energy technologies and what state they're in. I mean, solar and wind have had the same problems forever, which is just that they're very dilute. So you have to spend a lot of resources concentrating them. And even more importantly, they're intermittent. So you have to spend a lot of resources trying to store them so you can deliver them reliably. And that's why there's not one freestanding solar plant or wind plant in the world, and why even in a place like Germany, they're providing 6% of the energy total and none of it reliably.
What do you mean by freestanding in that sense? That doesn't rely on fossil fuels in the
yeah, like we think of a power plant, as this independent thing that you can plug like a hospital into, and that that could really run a grid. And so there's no solar grid, there's no wind grid, on a large level, leaving aside something like using solar for a small heating system or to run a small battery or to heat a pool or something like that, where you can deal with the intermittency or you're willing to pay more in the case of solar and the battery if you want to live a low energy off-grid lifestyle, there's no grid run by solar. So it's really accurate to say there's actually no such thing as solar electricity. There's solar coal, there's solar hydro, there's solar oil insofar as oil is used for electricity, which isn't that much. There's solar gas. Same thing with wind. And I think it's just really remarkable and dishonest the extent to which the intermittency problem is ignored. And in much of our energy discussion, for instance, the rating of in megawatts or in kilowatts of the facilities, the idea that you will rate like a nuclear power plant and a wind farm, except with a nuclear power plant, you rate it like, let's say it's a gigawatt. That means it can actually produce a gigawatt. And the wind farm, if it was a gigawatt, which is a ton for a wind farm. That means that if the wind is blowing perfectly, which is almost never happening, it's a gigawatt.
And what do the numbers look like in terms of how much of our energy is supplied by solar versus fossil fuels versus wind on a international level or a national level?
You're looking at numbers differ, but you're looking around 2%, but it's an expensive 2%. So I don't think – let's put it this way. If all the solar panels and windmills disappeared from the face of the earth tomorrow – you could very much argue it would be an economic benefit, and it certainly would not be hard to replace. If you took away the hydroelectric dams or the nuclear power plants and certainly the fossil fuels, it would be a huge, huge loss. And I think that really shows that these core technologies, hydro, nuclear, and particularly fossil fuels, they're doing the real work, and the others are, as Peter Beckman once called them, rich men's toys.
And what would you say to the argument if someone is listening to this, which probably is not the case, but maybe a very big devotee of these technologies?
But that, by the way, how weird is that? Like you're a devotee of solar.
Yeah, it is.
Why
kind
do
of strange,
you care?
Yeah.
I mean, if you work in the industry, that you're a devotee in the sense of you're attempting to solve a problem. But even there, if I was working solar, I'd admit, look, we're pretty much junk compared to the things that are actually leading the way. So I just. the reason I interjected there is because the devoteeism, if that's the word for it, that is ideological. And it's ultimately religious. It comes from the idea that the ideal is to live in harmony with nature and that somehow using the sun and the wind is a more natural way of being. So if you look at Apple's website and they have this complete lie, which I've written about on medium.com, about how all their servers are powered, you know, just by quote unquote renewables. But they say, you know, when you download something from the iTunes store, the energy comes from nature. And you can just see it's this naturism or nature worship. Of course, they ignore that you have to, you know, mine an unbelievable amount to get the raw materials for these resource intensive processes to quote get your energy from nature. But nevertheless, that's the ideal. And so we have it work again. They're not optimizing for maximizing human well-being. They're trying to minimize human impact. And that's their quote excitement that we might have a form of energy that doesn't actually do very much to the earth.
But isn't there something to be said for that? I mean, is if you would rather build something with less impact versus building something with more impact, if those were the only two variables.
Impact on what?
So let's say we'll choose something. Impact on air quality, and let's say everything else is equal. You would rather, so we're just going to hold everything constant. It'd be better to build something with less impact on air quality than more.
Correct? Right, but then on the standard of maximizing human well-being, then it would maximize human well-being because you'd have all aspects constant, and then one is optimized. So that's an easy thing.
Exactly.
But it's interesting.
But that's, I think, where people are thinking. I think that they think sun is
well,
is a replacement.
Because
and
this
like
is
that.
A point that came up this morning in the Cato Talk on the Hill, which I believe will be available online when people listen to this podcast. One of the key points that really struck me early on and got me interested in energy was the idea that all forms of energy are not created equal. And really, energy shouldn't be thought of as a material. It's not like the sun or the wind or coal or oil. Energy is a process. It's taking a whole bunch of elements and combining them together and seeing, can I get out of this? Can I use few enough resources here, everything combined, so that the output is cheap, reliable, and most difficult, perhaps scalable? And when I studied the history of oil, it was fascinating that you had at least six major competitors to oil before oil became dominant, but none of them could do the job of lighting up the countryside. Oil was the first cheap, reliable, scalable solution. And the fossil fuel industry is still the leader today because they keep developing more and more technology, and there's so much fossil fuel matter in the earth. So solar and wind have incredibly inefficient processes. So part of it is this dogma or this way of thinking, would we like the sun to power it or would we like coal to power it? But that's not the question. Is would we like the sun plus all these other mined materials with all that expense or would we like coal? And I'd say I like coal with those other – with the process.
This sounds then like the problems with these alternatives are often the tech just isn't there to make them work as well as fossil fuels. Which means that presumably it's possible that there would be non-fossil fuel alternatives that if we simply had enough technological growth we could get to and they'd work. And there's an argument that you hear a lot that part of the reason that say solar is inefficient, doesn't work very well,
wind doesn't work
very well is because the fossil fuel industry, which has obviously an incentive to maintain its position mm-hmm. in the industry – just because of the financial rewards that come with it, works against that. It funds studies that show the alternatives don't work, or
it has congressmen in their pockets, and it's basically keeping it down.
There's a number of varieties. I think the most popular one is not as much sort of the they're withholding patents and this kind of thing, but rather the subsidies argument that you hear. It's if you actually look at all what they'll call the externalities, these costs that are we're destroying the planet, but it's not accounted for in the price that you pay. Whereas so if you added them all up, it turns out solar and wind would be cheaper. The first thing to say about that is if that were true, that would be really bad, because if the best priced energy was actually solar, we'd have to be really, really poor. Because what they're saying is not that solar can actually be super cheap. they're just saying oil should be super expensive and inefficient like solar. So that's a bad sign. And if you
so
just,
that's something we should lament and say this is
yeah,
this is
no,
sad.
They never lament, yeah. Which is very revealing. They don't lament the loss of, you know, by far your cheapest, most reliable, most scalable source of energy. They're sort of gleeful at it, which is another indication that they're not trying to maximize human well-being. They're trying to minimize impact. And ultimately, my belief is, and I explain why toward the end of the book, really the objection toward energy is not, to put it in software terms, is not the bugs. It's not the, you know, pollution or, you know, the difficulty of finding new resources. It's actually the feature. Energy is a means of impacting nature for human benefit. So if you believe that our goal should be to minimize impact, to be green, how could you be in favor of having lots and lots and lots of energy? And I give the example in the late 80s when people thought that nuclear fusion might be practical, and this was the holy grail in terms of cheap, reliable, scalable energy on you know, that was cleaner than anything imaginable. And a lot of the thought leaders like Amory Lovins and Paul Ehrlich and Jeremy Rifkin, I think, you know, they said this would be the worst thing. And Ehrlich called it, he said it would be like giving an idiot child a machine gun for us to have so much cheap, clean, reliable energy. And the idea is he thinks of our human activity powered by energy as like a machine gun, right? He thinks because nature, preserving nature from us is the goal. He doesn't want to improve the planet for human beings. He wants to save it from human beings.
And that seems like a very common thing you hear. There's the feature, another feature of oil is growth. Consumption, what was called consumption, usually people who use that word is they're using it pejoratively, but mm-hmm. like that, oh, do you think we should just be consuming? Is that where we're going to go? Just consuming right. and consuming until the earth is dried up and all these things. And Paul Ehrlich says that one of the people who says, yes, this is something we should avoid, human flourishing is something that is bad, he's almost saying, you think, mm-hmm. in a way, and that consumption is bad. Which seems like a religious type of view almost, as you mentioned.
Well, I've started calling the underlying view here, which is something that unites both the climate catastrophism and pollution catastrophism and resource catastrophism, I call it the perfect planet premise. So this is the idea that nature gave us a perfect planet, and it gave us the resources that we need, and it gave us the friendly environment we need. And pretty much every time we take an action, every time we make a footprint, we're jeopardizing, you know, the delicate balance of that perfect planet. Now, this would have been a laughable, if not tragic, idea for anyone who lived, say, 300 years ago when they lived in the undisturbed planet and lived till 30 and, you know, had kids die at childbirth and had a horrific climate in the sense of they couldn't cope with it, so that, you know, a drought comes and some of your population gets wiped out. You know, climate is not perfect. Nothing about nature is perfect by the standard of human well-being. Climate is naturally variable. It's always changing. It's volatile, can change violently, and it's vicious. It can do all sorts of things to deprive us of the temperatures that we need or the water that we need, and, you know, can certainly attack us with all sorts of storms. So to get that to then the resource point, the resource is the perfect planet gives us all the resources that we need unless we're greedy, unless we consume. Because once we consume those resources, they'll be gone. But then I ask the question, who has more resources, us or the caveman? Because we've been consuming so many resources, right? We've been gobbling them up. It sure looks like we have a lot more resources than he does. And this gets to the point which, you know, Ayn Rand makes well, George Reisman makes well, Julian Simon makes well, that I'll put it in my own words, resources are created. The earth, there's a difference between raw materials and resources. The earth is just one big ball of raw materials and energy, and it's enormous potential. But to make it usable resources requires human ingenuity. And so the ultimate resource, as Simon would put it, is the mind. And so the thing we have to worry about is not running out of oil. It's running out of freedom to use our mind to create new resources, whether it's more oil resources in the case of something like the shale revolution or new nuclear resources, you know, which I think will ultimately be the most promising thing down the road.
Should the – call it the good of the planet, or for lack of a better term, so the quality of the environment, pristine, you know, undisturbed landscapes or animal species, whatever, should that enter into our moral calculus at all?
Whose environment?
Humans, beavers.
Yeah. So what, animals, like non-human.
Animals,
so like
yes.
So every non-human?
I'm saying should those things – if we're choosing trade-offs, so fossil mm-hmm. fuels have these trade-offs because they produce some externalities. Other means of energy have other trade-offs and other sorts of externalities. Should we care at all? Is there ever a point where we would say like it's not right to say
strip mine this entire
area or wipe out this species? Should we
So there's two things. One is partially the legal framework by which you deal with these things. So that's all – just really quickly on that. I don't like – I think externality thinking and economics applied to politics is almost completely invalid and very harmful to thinking about it. And in part, it's based on the premise in part that prices are supposed to be – are perfect measures of value, which directly contradicts the fundamental of modern economics, which is the marginal theory of prices. So if you think about like when you pay $3 a gallon for an oil product, are you getting $3 of value out of it? Well, only one person really is, the marginal buyer, right? He was buying for $3. That's – let's say he buys the oil in the form of a Barbie doll and pays $3. And he wouldn't – it wouldn't even be worth $3.01. But of course on the rest of the scale, all of the rest of us were willing to pay more than $3. That's how the price system works. And let's say it was the prescription drug that saved my life. I might be willing to pay $100,000 for the gallon that produced that, or you know, you're taking your wife to the hospital. So this is called the consumer surplus in economics. But it's very important because if you're trying to measure the value of different things and you're talking about, oh, there are these hidden costs. But there's by the nature of how prices work, there are always hidden benefits. The thing is always worth more than you pay for it. And that dynamic is dramatically different depending on the product. So the more fundamental the product to human life, like energy, the more dramatic the consumer surplus. So if you start talking about, oh, the hidden – if anyone starts talking about, oh, the hidden costs without the hidden benefits, they are thinking about it horribly. So that's – I think that's why it's an illogical way of calculating sort of general economic good. But then legally, I think it's also a problem. I mean, if you murder me, do we call that an externality? I mean, you could put a price. Why would you put a price on it? It's a rights violation. If I start a hog farm next to someone's house and ruin his life, is that an – I mean, maybe you can put a tort on it and put a cost on it. But we think of it as a rights violation. So I think in general pollution we should put into a rights violation framework, and we should have thresholds for things like emissions that are based on the current technology. So for instance, in the 1800s you'd have a much like higher level of air pollution or air contamination that you'd accept because coal was essential and you didn't have much of a means of limiting it. Whereas today we should never accept those kinds of standards because we don't have to. We have the technology. So I talk about this a bit in Chapter 7 of the book, but I just wanted to say that about externalities, and because my own philosophical framework is an individualistic one. It's not that, oh, I think you too can use fossil fuels, and I don't think it's okay for you guys to use fossil fuels and benefit your life and extend it by 40 years in exchange for me dying. Like that's not the point at all. And this also helps – so the property rights individualistic framework also helps clarify the rest of nature. So I don't believe that the rest of nature has intrinsic value, any given part of it. But it has specific value to specific human beings. So we just think about a garden or something like that. In your house, when you have a house or a piece of property, you don't just randomly build stuff on it to say, oh, I impacted things, right? This is not how we think. You're maximizing its value. You're maximizing your well-being, which means that maybe the natural beauty of it is a big value. You know, we pay a lot of money for these kinds of things, and that's terrific. Like, you know, I love going to the beach in Orange County. And unfortunately, I don't own any beachfront property, and in part because all these climate catastrophists are hypocrites and won't sell it to me at a discount, which they should if the sea levels were actually going to rise dramatically. But nevertheless, I love going to the beach. And if someone said, "Hey, let's just build a," I don't know. I don't know what they would try to build on the beach, but you know, let's make it inaccessible to you so you can't enjoy the ocean. I'd have a big problem with that. Now, I think it should be privately owned. I think you'd solve it that way, but. There's a value, but it's always a value to human beings. There's no such being as the planet. The planet is just a rock that has a bunch of species, and you have to decide whose species perspective are you going to look at environment from. And so human versus non-human is a big distinction, and so I care about the human environment from a value perspective, and I don't care about the mosquito environment. although there might be some circumstance I wanted to preserve the mosquito, and surely there are circumstances in which I want to exterminate it.
And even if you wanted to look at it, it's an interesting point because you could say, okay, well, it's bears. Like just choose anything. Let's maximize value to bears. In order to keep bears alive, you'd have to impact the environment in some way, right? They'd have to eat. They'd have to impact it in some way. So they're going to have some impact on anything to keep anything alive. It's going to have some sort of impact.
Right, but let me ask this. I think – let me try to ask the question a different way because okay. I think it gets to the motivation for a lot of people who are opposed to the use of fossil fuels mm-hmm. or at least would like to invest more in trying to discover alternatives.
Of their money or mine?
Either way.
Either way.
Either way.
Because those are not equal.
Yeah, no, I agree. But
or at least think that we ought to. So they would implore you to invest some of your money
with
and
the gun,
me
yes.
and whatever. But the – so imagine a situation where you have a – you've bought a chunk of land mm-hmm. and there are – there's a – some sort of animal species on that chunk of land and there's some sort of like – you know it's maybe it's a piece of like the Grand Canyon. So it's some piece of kind of like uniquely beautiful nature is on that land mm-hmm. And you would take pleasure in killing every member of that animal species that's on your land. You would just gain some sort of hedonistic joy in the action of it.
Well, but it's different if it's for sport or for, yes. for food okay, but or we could, for, we, but, for nihilism.
Sure. But the point is – if or you decide you want to this chunk of the Grand Canyon, you want to somehow demolish it, fill it in, something like that.
Okay.
So you're not violating anyone's rights. It's
correct.
Your property. You know, you're not limiting anyone else's access to it because it was already yours. It wasn't theirs. But would there be any grounds for morally judging that as a blameworthy or wrong act?
Oh yeah. Well, I mean, there's an property rights and morality are certainly very related and you know that's a whole interesting issue of moral and political philosophy. But I mean think about it more broadly. There are many moral judgments you can make, at least I think you can make, about how a person uses his property. I mean just – or you know other things associated. For example, you watch somebody how they treat their kids and there are lines in terms of you know, if they openly beat their kids then you know you can report them. To the police. But if what if it's just you know they're yelling at them or they're saying things that you think are psychologically harmful or even you're sending them to a school that you think will brainwash them. I mean there, these things are incredibly tragic that we do to human beings, never you know let alone animals or flower beds or whatever. And in particular any kind of act of nihilism which is just destruction for the sake of destruction, which you see people who abuse animals. You know it's very disturbing kind of thing or people – I mean what would be their motivation if it was just some really beautiful part of Grand Canyon? Now fortunately if it's really beautiful it would be priced very high so the person's nihilism he'd have to pay a lot of money you know to enforce it would be pretty rare. But just to take something that either you acknowledge is beautiful or other people do and just destroy it for its own sake, that's fortunately pretty rare. I think the motivation I'm worried about is the people who – you know to go back to your bear point – the people who it's not really that they care about any particular species or all – you can't care about all species but that the only criterion of moral action is that your impact not benefit a human being. So as long as it's for the sake of any other species, as long as it's the, you know, the rainforest or the polar bear or whatever, nobody can judge you. But if you say, no, I want to prioritize a human being, it's you're not being green and you're not being green. But that means that being green is evil if that's what it means, if it means non-impact. And it's this it's a morality, you know, Ayn Rand I think would call it like sacrifice for the sake of sacrifice. It's a nihilism about human beings. So this in the same way that you would be nihilistic in just, you know, just maiming a dog or something like that. It's you're just saying all I care about is that human beings sacrifice. For what? I don't care. It could be a polar bear. It could be a mosquito. It could be the tundra. It could be Anwar. Like any kind of wasteland or you know from ugly to beautiful, as long as a human being is sacrificing and not making another footprint on Earth, I'm happy. And that I call human racism. You like every race on the planet allegedly except for the human race.
So that's a good segue back into the one – big part of your book being the how much fossil fuel use has benefited humanity.
Yes.
And so how much has it benefited humanity?
Well, I think this goes to an earlier point that was raised about just the benefits of fossil fuels are overwhelmingly the benefits of energy. So the core benefit of fossil fuels is that it produces cheap, plentiful, reliable energy on a scale that no other form of energy has been able to do. And that's part of why we don't want to be partisan about it. Like, I say I love fossil fuels.
You just like energy.
But yes. It's really – yeah, I love energy, but I respect how difficult it is to produce it on that scale. And so I respect what the fossil fuel industry does when it's doing that. If it does something bad, then of course I don't respect that. But if we look at then what has been the impact of being this – the one industry that can produce this kind of energy on this scale, it's really the question of what is the value of energy. And a big theme of the book is that this is not – appreciated at all. And one of my motivations for writing it and for getting into the field is that I didn't appreciate energy at all before I started studying the history of it. And so the way I like to think of it is this. Just like our body needs calories to function and to do work, so our machines need calories to function and to do work. So energy is really machine calories. Technically, it's the capacity to do work, but it's really the capacity of our machines to do work. Now, we as human beings are very, very weak in terms of the amount of physical work we can do to improve our lives. And this is one of the core explanations as to why human beings historically did not live at a level that we would consider acceptable. Life expectancy of 30, huge infant mortality rates, inability to cope with climate, all of these, starvation, shortages, all kinds of afflictions. Because the average human being, we use about as much energy as a 100-watt light bulb, which is just not, not that much.
You mean our bodies.
Yeah, our bodies. Yeah. Our bodies in terms of, because ultimately everything goes back to some sort of physical work. And that's simply not enough to really sustain our population in the way that we would like to. So what we do is we have this ingenious invention of, hey, let's create these things called machines. But instead of us, we can only take in so many calories and use them. Then we just, sort of gain weight, like has been happening on this, radio tour of mine, because I'm not exercising as much, and then I'm, taking in calories, but I'm not becoming like incredibly powerful from the lobster grilled cheese sandwich I just had. But what we can do, the nice thing about machines is they have no limit, at least in the aggregate, of how many calories they can use. So the more machine calories we can produce, the more machines we can produce along with them, the more work that can be done. And I use the stat in the book. It's around the average American uses about 96 human equivalents worth of machines. So it's like I have 96 human beings doing work for me just based on my energy expenditures and other expenditures, which is just amazing. And you just look at wherever in life we use machines, whether it's to manufacture pharmaceuticals or to do modern farming or for a family to go to a wedding or even for me to just come in Cato and for the temperature to be comfortable and to have all this amazing equipment, how to get manufactured. Every single thing is enhanced by machines, and every machine is running on machine food. And as soon as that dries up, as soon as it becomes unaffordable or scarce, all this stuff doesn't work. It's like a blackout. And so in a real way, the environmentalist movement, by opposing fossil fuels, is a blackout movement.
What about the argument that gets raised by the environmentalist movement that that's all great and it's wonderful that we have these machines and that they're being powered, but we're running out of the stuff, that we're the peak oil argument or whatever. And so if we aren't putting our energy into these other alternatives, no matter how inefficient they might be right now, we're going to hit a wall.
Well, first of all, whenever anyone begins a sentence like that, like, oh, it's great and all, and about the one innovation that doubled the human life expectancy, I'm very suspicious of the kind of mode. And it shows that in terms of the balance of things, the benefits to human beings don't seem to carry much emotional resonance, and then they'll start weeping over a polar bear for 9 minutes.
It's a really good point. It's like, oh, that's great and all. You've doubled human life expectancy, that you've fed billions of people. You've halved infant mortality, that we have lights, that we have computers, that we can go on internet. But what about running out of the stuff? Yeah, you're right.
Well, I think that's partly though because the environmentalist movement is largely – so it's in the fairly rich West, mm-hmm. right? And so they're not – when they're thinking about these machines and the uses of energy, my guess is that what they have in mind is what we'll call like the more frivolous uses, like you're powering up your TV or right. you're running these things that we could all live without. They're not thinking about – the hospitals and the life-saving machines and the stuff that allows us to farm much more efficiently and whatever
else. Yeah, those run together though, because it's kind of like if somebody says, hey, Alex, you know what? I think you wasted 40% of your money last year. So I'm going to take away that money next year and it'll just be fine. I would say, okay, well, you're welcome to give me some advice and give me your judgment, but I would like that money still, and now I can use it better, because money is a fundamental form of opportunity and energy is also a fundamental form of opportunity. So I want more opportunity to use machines to improve my life. So I agree that those kind of luxuries are the stand-in, but I think that's a lot of corruption by the intellectuals, and they definitely don't get or don't want to get or don't care about the core value to human life. So which question were
we on? So what about running out?
Yeah, the other thing that's just it's always interesting how questions are phrased and how questions intersect or integrate or disintegrate or contradict one another, because with this one, think about it. One set of whole worries is we have way too much of this stuff, so we're going to destroy the environment with pollution and with catastrophic climate change. And on the other hand, we don't have enough. So fossil fuels are bad because there's too many of them, and fossil fuels are bad because there's too few of them. So this kind of implies that – you could argue there's some consistency there, but it implies that there's some sort of more meta level aversion to what's going on. And with the – so with the alternatives issue, it's – in a sense, it's almost too dumb an argument to even know where to begin, because in just an economic sense, what happens when we start running low on anything? It's not like fossil fuels are unique in this way. You know, with different things, they can become more expensive to produce or, you know, whatever. It becomes more scarce, you know, just like in speaking. Let's say this book goes really, really well and I'm – you know, people want Alex Epstein to speak, and you know, the bureau, Lee Bureau, like who represents me, you know, they start jacking up the price, and then for some people they can't afford it anymore. And okay, what do? Well, they hear you guys on the podcast and they say, well, actually I think you're just as good or maybe even better, so we'll start jacking up your rate. And then you get to like what happens? It's called substitution, right? You know, demand rises relative to supply, the price goes up and you have substitution. This is how any kind of thing works. And that's the point at which it's rational. And you have futures markets which anticipate these dynamics. But basically, you should always use the best thing. And when it's no longer the best thing, and as futures markets indicate that it's not the best thing, you start using other things. But the real – you notice how eager they are to believe, oh, we're going to run out of it. Because it's really the perfect planet premise. They just think, oh, we can't have that many resources, or we can't have that much ability to get more of it. And they're very sort of skeptic. They're very unmoved by the fact that these predictions have been coming wrong for 100, really 200 years now. So that's – there's sort of the basic supply and demand thing, which I think that's sort of the core answer in terms of the policy is what I call progressive energy. So we just keep using the best form, and that will continue to evolve just like cell phones do. And fossil fuels are likely going to be that for the vast majority of people for, you know, many decades to come. And we certainly have the supplies to do that. We just need the freedom.
In the book, you write about how you think that the fears of global warming are somewhat exaggerated, but
somewhat.
Well, they're exaggerated by some many people, but it seems like even if they aren't, let's just say we were just going to say, I will take everything that you have and say you're right. I won't even argue against your global warming premise. And there's still a moral case for fossil fuels. Right? Mm-hmm. It seems interesting to me. I always say that there are about 3 billion people on this planet who don't have enough energy at all, and energy equals wealth, as you point out, essentially. And if we're caring about people who don't yet exist and trying to make energy more expensive for 3 billion people who really mm-hmm. need to live a satisfying life or would like to, then we're doing something very immoral to them in the name of unknown and distant possibly catastrophes. And so it's still, even if they're correct, there's still a fundamental moral case for fossil fuels.
Well, I take a little bit of issue with that in the sense of I don't like statements such as even if they're correct, because a lot of the methodology here is all about precision and a lot of nuance. So it's like, oh, are you correct about global warming? But what do you mean? Do you mean
the catastrophic theory is
correct? But even what that means, right? Because we have we're talking about a guaranteed energy catastrophe if we start restricting it, and I think there is already an energy catastrophe for 3 billion people. So you need to be specific. And what I find from the data and from my own just thinking about it is that when we talk about, you know, even a climate catastrophe, it's very difficult to even make one up. And the reason is because technology is such a powerful force for mitigating climate, and climate is so inherently dangerous. So people wonder, how could it be that in the last 80 years, climate-related deaths have gone down by 80%? And last year, supposedly the worst year ever for climate, you know, it's so dangerous, so many wildfires, whatever they say, had under 30,000 climate-related deaths worldwide, even that includes the non-industrialized world. And in the 30s, you had years where it's over 3 million, you know, 3 million compared to 30,000, and where you had less than one-third of our population. You know, so it's more like 10 million compared. How can that possibly happen? And the answer is the perfect planet premise is just so wrong. Again, climate is naturally variable, volatile, and vicious. And the task with climate is not to try to not impact it. It's to try to fight it.
To try to survive it.
To try to master it. Yeah, that's why one of the chapters is called Climate Mastery. And as we get better technology, we can just continue to master it more and more. So the fossil fuel industry is part of, not the only part of, but I think a truly heroic and untold story of climate mastery, which I'm tempted to write a book on, just the history of, you know, man's dependence on climate and being at the mercy of climate and how that's improved. And in fact, Indur, Goklany of Cato has written some really good stuff on that. So I just say that with all these things, the main point to drive home is we want the method of focusing on human well-being and focusing on the big picture, and that means a lot of precision on both sides. So I don't like saying like, oh, I'll grant you global warming or even catastrophism. I want to know exactly what you're saying. Now, if you mean 100-foot sea level rise in a year,
that'd be a problem.
That's like a World War III and IV and V combined. Though that's not even predicted by the climate prediction models that can't predict climate that we're supposed to bow to.
This climate mastery, I'm wondering if you could just kind of give us some examples of what that looks like in practice. Like, what are the things between the 1930s and now that we have been able to do that have caused these deaths to drop so dramatically?
Oh yeah, there's so many good ones. I mean, my favorite one is I just think of thunderstorms, like just a normal thunderstorm. And you can have the exact same, and in part because there's a scene in Atlas Shrugged, which is one of my favorite books about this. And as I was writing the book, I reread the scene, and many listeners are probably familiar with Atlas Shrugged. If you're not, definitely take a look at it. But you know, two of the heroes of the book are talking, and they're having this very romantic evening. You know, at least what's supposed to be a romantic evening at this guy Hank Reardon's house. And it's just this fierce storm outside, and one of the characters named Francisco says it's you know, it's a really bad night to be an animal tonight, and it's a really good night to be a human. And this is the idea that outside the weather, nature is attacking every living being. It's, you know, it's the winds are fierce, and yet we're in here with beautiful gowns and enjoying fine china and all this kind of thing. And it's the kind of evening where you can imagine you know, a man proposing to his girlfriend, and they'll remember this romantic thunderstorm. And then you go back 300 years before we have any kind of mastery, and this could kill a whole family, right? It could be like the worst moment of your life or the best moment of your life, depending on your degree of mastery. You can take the same thing with agriculture. Indur Goklany, again, has some great stuff on this where, you know, in the past, we talk about drought. Drought is really not having as much water as you want. And that's a problem that technology is gradually eliminating, because in the past, just nature doesn't give you that. The reason why they talk so much about this is a bumper crop, this is a bad crop. Nature doesn't give you what you need all the time or even most of the time. So if you had one, two bad years, you can start eating your stock seed. Everything can go bad. And now we can irrigate. Right, we can purify water. Hopefully, we'll be able to desalinate water. We can do so much And the principle is we need to not be saving the planet from human beings. We need to improve it for human beings because it's not a perfect planet. It's a perfectible planet, but it is not a perfect planet.
And that's – yeah, everything. Irrigation, if you dig the ditch – if you're irrigating, let's just say, straight with canals, you dig the ditch with some sort of industrial machine, some sort of construction machine that runs on fossil fuels as opposed to digging it with your shovels. Everything is moving people around, getting them out of the way with cars, right? So an earthquake or maybe a tsunami alert happens and you get them out of the way of it. So many different ways to avoid the kind of damage or the deaths you're talking about.
And to just take – since we're here talking about ideas, I think it's worth pointing out that one of the greatest benefits of having cheap, plentiful, reliable energy on a large scale is that you can have more and more people devoted to thinking and discovery of new knowledge. So things like being able to better predict the weather are crucial. Now, unfortunately, that can be distorted to the point where we have these very bad climate predictions telling us that we should get rid of the energy source that allowed us to predict the weather in the first place. But nevertheless, you know, from any field that has advanced intellectually, that is a product of the fossil fuel industry, and they should be, you know, given their measure of credit for it.
But isn't it true that, you know, despite all this discussion of these models and everything, isn't it true? You hear it all the time that 97% of scientists believe in catastrophic man-made global warming problems.
Yeah, so there are a couple, and this. Anyone is interested, check out again the Cato talk that'll I'm sure be at Cato.org because we discussed 97%, you know, maybe for 15 minutes. Or I used it as a case study in the ways in which we're taught to think illogically about fossil fuels. And kind of the first question, if you hear 97% agree with anything, first question is what exactly do they agree to? I really need to know that clearly. And then how do I know they agree? And then why do they agree? I need explanations of all of those things. And usually with 97%, none of those three things are forthcoming.
I think there's probably flat earthers maybe who are more than 3% of the population. So you maybe couldn't even find 97% of people who think that the earth is round.
Yeah. So you sort of dig into this and it's really fascinating because the original claim, which comes from a couple of journal articles, is 97% believe that the warming over the last 150 years of 0.8 degrees Celsius or 1.3 degrees Fahrenheit is mostly caused by human activity, so over 50%.
Mostly meaning over 50% caused.
Yeah, mostly. So okay, so you're talking like 0.4 degrees, you know, 0.65 degrees Fahrenheit. So what's interesting though is that is used – it's used not to simply make that claim about temperature agnostically because that claim by itself has no moral significance. You don't know if it's even good to be warmer or not and you certainly don't know if that magnitude is alarming, although the fact that you cannot even physically discern it yourself without complex instruments sort of indicates it, you know, in particular since you have the trend tapering off recently, not accelerating. What's interesting is that is never used just as a sort of clinical observation to add as one piece of the puzzle. It is used for politicians to say 97% of scientists agree with climate catastrophe, and really it's used to say 97% of scientists agree with my particular policies. So a good object lesson, which I discuss in chapter 4 of the book and which you can also look up online, is John Kerry's speech to Indonesia where he kind of famously said, the science is leaping out at us like a 3D movie and make no mistake, this is absolutely certain. And then he starts out talking about how most of the warming, he doesn't say how much, but you know, most of it he doesn't say how much total warming there is. Most of it comes from man-made causes. And then by the end of the same paragraph, he's gone from 97% say the warming is mostly caused by man to 97% agree that it's an incredibly massive danger. So my background's in philosophy. This is a straight fallacy called equivocation, using the same word, in this case 97%, or same two words, to mean two different things to manipulate somebody. So it is a really, really revealing and bad example of the horrific state of logic in these discussions. So what we actually need is for experts to tell us precisely what they know and what they don't know and then explain their reasoning for both. And if that were the – and then contribute that to the broader discussion so climate scientists can tell us objectively, look, what do we know? What's speculation? What's maybe probabilistic? But then economists can contribute, right? And physicists can contribute and biologists can contribute about biological issues. And this is kind of what the UN claims to be doing, but it does not differentiate – to say the least, it does not differentiate between fact and speculation. And so what you have is these scientific organizations being using these incredible equivocations. In the case of organizations like the American Physical Society, which represents physicists for God's sake, you know, they're making political prescriptions. But how could you make a political prescription about fossil fuels if you don't know about the relative value of its energy? What the hell does a physicist know about energy economics? So he could – for all he knows, he could be sentencing 4 billion people to death through energy catastrophe because he thinks it's a problem that it's a little bit warmer. So it's the 97% of scientists – and then on top of that, the 97% as I talk about again in chapter 4 isn't even true, and the studies that do that are say that they're based on more than 50%, but they include studies that say any percent. So that's another equivocation. I mean, that's saying most, but most can mean over 50% or over 0%. So the whole – one point I want to make is the whole state of climate communication is a complete illogical racket, and you do not need to be a climate scientist to know that it is incredibly morally corrupt and that it needs to be completely redone, and many of these people need to be jettisoned from the cultural discussion.
Well, it seems like everyone is either being called a denier or an affirmer. So the 97%
of what?
Is
– Nobody
exactly,
knows.
Exactly. You're either affirming 97% or you're denying, and there's no nuance between the two.
But the only thing that's being denied is energy, as in they want to deny billions of people of energy. That's a proper use of the term. You don't use deny for issues that are being debated. Like your moral case for fossil fuels denier. Like, okay, that's a little bit biasing the discussion there, I'd say.
So if you were given the opportunity to be, say, in charge of US energy policy or had the ability to change the narrative the way we talk about these things, how should we be approaching questions of how we get our energy today, how we would get our energy in the future?
Well, I mean, I think I have had the opportunity. I mean, you know, Penguin gave me the opportunity to write the book, and I did my best to frame everything. And Pat Michaels and I were talking about this today. I think that the idea of he who frames wins. I mean, you want to frame things. The side that frames the issues will win. And I think ultimately, if both sides are trying their best to frame it, the side with the most logic can frame it the best. So I'd say the moral case is a way of framing it that's laser focused on human well-being, not minimizing human impact. It's laser focused on the big picture. It's laser focused on precision, and it's laser focused on using experts not as authorities but as advisors and explainers. And so I'm really happy with the opportunity, and I'm happy to get the opportunity to be on podcasts like this. And you know, I don't know that I don't think of myself as, oh, I want to run the Department of Energy. I'm interested in changing the way people think about energy. So just the opportunity to be here and talk to you guys is – that's honestly what excites me. And you know, I hope that people check out the book, and you can check out chapter one for free at moralcaseforfossilfuels.com, and that's the secret history of fossil fuels. So you can see if do I like this framework. But I hope from this interview people at least get – there's something really off with the way we talk about these issues, and we could probably be using a better method. And I think if we do use a better method, we'll have a much higher estimate of fossil fuels. But in any case, if we use a better method, we'll come to a lot better answers than we are right now.
Thanks for listening. If you have any questions or comments about today's episode, you can find us on Twitter at FreeThoughtsPod. That's FreeThoughtsPod. Free Thoughts is a project of Libertarianism.org and the Cato Institute, and is produced by Evan Banks. To learn more, you can find us on the web at www.libertarianism.org.